Certainly in electronics, who didn't go overseas. And I tried to get a job from placement here. So I got a job at DCM Data Products to sell computers. These companies don't even exist anymore, by the way. They've all disappeared from the face of the earth. So I got a job to sell computers, and I was posted in Pune. And I found it such a miserable, what should I say, depressing experience selling computers to people who had no clue what a computer is, right, who wanted it just for status. At that time, they wanted it because they'll put a big box on their table. Everyone will say, "Bhai, iske paas to computer hai. You've got a very computer." And I realized that, you know, I'm not going to be doing this. I was also clear that I was not going to go into the hardcore technical area. And, you know, I got into engineering, like I said, not necessarily out of choice, but out of default, right? Not by design, by default. So I got into engineering. And I also realized in IIT that there were guys much better than me at engineering. So I said, let them go and do what they're going to do much better than I will ever be able to do. They're much smarter than I am. They could understand many of the lectures better than I ever could, right? So, you know, some of these things just let me down saying that, yeah, I'm not going to do engineering, but initially I said I'd like to do something connected with technology. And that's why at that time, computer hardware was just, you know, I mean, IIT still had one mainframe computer at that time when we passed out, one. So I went into trying to sell computers. It didn't work. Applied for IIM and did summer training in IIM with Hindustan Lever, and just got enamored by the world of consumers and brands. Just enamored with the world of consumers and brands. And that's what I've done ever since.
So we are the MD students from IIT Madras, and we have just started over 2 years. So I just want to ask you about FMCG. If somebody really wants to a career in FMCG and interested in all these things, so how can we get our basics clear? You know, how can we start, how can we make these 2 years more fruitful and get the, so that we will be prepared for the industries in FMCG companies?
So, you know, there are certain things you will learn in the institute and certain things you will learn on the job. And the thing is to try and do as much of practical stuff as you can as well when you're in the institute. So if you maximize, really get value out of your internship and try and, I don't know if the institute helps with placement for internships here, but if it does, then try and intern in a place where you know that they will have a good internship program and where they will train you, okay? So we take our internship program very, very seriously. We take 40-50 management interns every year, and we take them very seriously, and there's serious feedback for the coach and so on if they don't deal with the interns well. And you know, 2/3 of the interns actually come back as final placement people into our company. So try and get internship into a place which will genuinely have a good program and will help you to learn. The second is, when you take courses, right? Now, choose courses based on interest. You might want to do finance, you may want to do marketing, you may want to do sales, whatever. In as many of those courses as possible, see how you can get some kind of an industry link. And I think it would be a good thing to see if you can connect with alumni on things like that. Because, you know, doing a project where you bring in the theory from what you learn in class, but a bit of the practice from the companies, is really the magic combination. I mean, that's the magic combination. And that's what you need to do. It will also tell you what really excites you in life. You know, what part of management excites you. But again, you know, it's not a sprint. There's no shortcut to this. You know, you will learn so much, yeah, and you must make the most of your 2 years here. And then you will learn so much when you just go out and start making sales calls, you know, morning to night, sweating it out, you know, in a remote part of the country, talking to a retailer who's chewing pan. You will learn as much from there too. It's the hard, that's where the business happens, and that's where the battles are fought. But I mean, I have no magic quick fix solution for you on this. But maximize the opportunity of every course is all I will say. And be choiceful about your courses. You know, try and see if you can get some sense of what you are likely to like. I mean, do you have a choice of courses? Could you choose which ones, which subjects to take? So, you know, see if you can talk to people and understand, yeah, what is this subject really about? And see whether that tickles your senses or not. You know, that's probably what I can say. Yeah?
Let's thank
on last, the ladies can't, you know, in this world, we can't allow the ladies not to speak.
Strategic changes that you have followed. One is like what we can see, that is the Shubharam thing. What are the other major changes which have led to such growth? I mean, it's a big thing. Like, what have you done in the 7 years?
I'll say the same things that I said about East Africa, you know. Exactly. Now, if you take my colleague here, I mean, I said the power of focus, you know, building power brands. Now, I'll give you an example. I don't know, do you all see quite a lot of Cadbury advertising? You know, we have compounded annual increased investment on advertising in Cadbury has been 45% in the last 6 years. We've grown advertising spend by 45% per annum. And all these brands like Dairy Milk or Five Star or Celebrations or Bonvita, now Oreo, I mean, each of these brands, you know, we have cut everything else that we were spending money on and focused on these, and tried to make sure that, you know, in this business, right copy, right advertising is half the battle. And then you've got to put the right money behind that advertising to give it the media weight. You have to get this combination right. So making sure you work with the right partners and so on. So the first is the power of focus on brands. The second big, I think, reason for transformation of sales performance and growth has been what we've done in sales. You know, I say very often, when your toothpaste runs out, and you get up in the morning and say, oh, bloody hell, this toothpaste tube is empty, you'll rush to the store to buy toothpaste, right? But you'll come out also with a bar of chocolate. But you won't rush to the store to buy a bar of chocolate. So this is about owning impulse. So, you know, the category has to accost you as a shopper when you walk into the store. People walk in to buy detergent or toothpaste, but walk out with chocolate. So what we have done in terms of sales transformation, to own now, have you gone to stores where you see these refrigerators on the countertops? We call them busy coolers, you would have seen it in the video. It has been fundamental to delivering right quality product because, you know, chocolate is a category that is designed to melt on your tongue, right? If it's hard and doesn't melt on your tongue, it's not chocolate, right? It's got to be gooey on your in your mouth, which means it melts at body temperature. Ambient temperature in India more often than not is above body temperature. So you get chocolate that is melted in the store. So we've put those busy coolers with a cold chain right behind it to make sure you own what we call the point of buying, the impulse point of buying, and you deliver it in a condition in which it is meant to be, so it's not melted. So these are really the two big things that we have done in the front end to drive this growth. And the last thing I will say is this, you know, we have changed the ambition of the business. And with hindsight, I changed it too little. I should have aimed for 30% growth and created capacity and an organization for 30. I only targeted 20 and we did 25, you know, but we changed the ambition. And for the first 6 months to a year, half the company was comprised of naysayers saying it won't happen. This growth will never happen, this performance will never happen. Quarter by quarter, month by month, you start showing people that it's possible. And then you build credibility and you build confidence. And today, people say, I want to grow at 30. And I say, sorry, I have only enough capacity to grow at 20. The whole mindset in the company has changed to a high growth mindset, where they want to be, where the whole company wants to be the best in the industry on growth and not be a follower. But I'm probably oversimplifying. Business strategy is not too complicated because I really believe that everybody must understand what our business strategy is, but it's not that simple either, as what I've said. So it's somewhere in the middle.
Thank you, sir, for the chocolate.
You're welcome. And,
yeah. You said you kill literally 5 brands of Kraft Foods.
Yeah.
How could you actually convince the people to whom these brands are dear? Did you use a data analysis as a tool or many other things?
So very good question, I must tell you. Because brands are emotional, right? And you know, one is the consumer, but the other is the brand manager. The person in the company who gave birth to that brand is still working in the company. And you now try and kill, it's like killing your child. Focusing on some brands versus the other is saying, choose 5 out of your 10 children who you'll focus on. It's that kind of an emotional decision, not easy to for anyone to make. So there were battles in the company on this, right? But you know, I don't know who said this, but when somebody said, what is the definition of strategy? Strategy is about what you will not do. The most important part of strategy is what you will not do. So, and the point about strategy is a point of view. You have some data to, you know, come to a point of view, but there's no certainty. 3 years later, you will know whether the strategy really delivered or didn't. So it's a point of view, and it was the point of view of the senior team at that time saying, this is what we will do, and we will put our neck on the line. The fact that I'm standing here today and telling you about this means the strategy worked. Otherwise, I'd be history, right? And that's also the way the corporate world works. You don't easily get a second chance on some of these things, particularly at senior levels. You put your neck on the line. Somebody will cut it if you don't deliver. It's pretty ruthless out there too, huh? It's not as sweet as the chocolate you've eaten.
All right.
Yeah.
Let's thank Mr. Arun Kripalu again for his very engaging presentation.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
And as a token of our appreciation, we have a small memento. I will invite his batchmate, Professor Devdas Menon, to give him the memento.
I think he's still young and there's still fire and chocolate in his belly. And I think those 10 lessons that he gave really applicable to whichever direction in life you would choose to go. He was one among many who took the corporate line, but in our batch, as in your batches, there will be people moving in different directions. Some of us stayed back in academics and in the profession. But I distinctly remember those days. He was our social secretary. And we did many things together. The key thing was to really enjoy your life in IIT and to grow and excel in whatever you wish to do. And I can see clearly that is the real drive that you see in Anand Kripalu even today. And I think in the many, many years to go, don't say that you want to be there only for 2 more years. I think there's a long way to go for him and for all of you. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Thank you.